Okay, any lights? Oh, wow, whose idea was this? Wow, so it looks like we're gonna do a one light kind of direct flash setup for a glamour shot. Oh, God. Hey gang, you heard that right. A one light direct flash glamour shot. Now along the way, if you have tried using direct flash without any modifiers, or even worse yet, put a speed light on top of your camera and aimed it straight at your subject, or even if you haven't and you've read some books about lighting, you've probably heard direct flash is not a good idea when you're photographing people. It's not flattering and it causes harsh shadows. On one hand, that's true. On the other hand, that's bull. It only causes those problems if you don't use it properly. Turns out this model happens to have 63, yes, she took the time to count them, 63 bikinis in her closet. I didn't have her bring all 63, but I had her bring about 10 of them, all solid colors, no prints, no patterns, no florals. The pictures are about her. And I decided what I'd do is I'd shoot all 10, I'd edit it down to maybe 5 and assemble a composite shot, with the goal being to show different personality and emotions all in one shot. So it's kind of a very fun way to show a model's range. I decided to keep it simple, so I'm going to have the model pose standing against a white wall. The flash, in this case, I'm going to use a studio strobe. It's placed about a foot to a foot and a half above my camera. I don't want it too close to the lens because indeed, I don't want to have red eye. But at the same time, I don't want it too far away from the lens because I don't want to exaggerate the shadows. I'll talk more about those in a minute. You could do this same thing with a speed light. I would recommend getting the speed light off camera so that it's a little further away from the lens axis. But as long as you're able to mount your speed light on camera and not get red eye, go for it. It will work in this scenario. The important piece, if you're going to use a speed light, you may find that if you're going to work against a white wall like I am, the TTL is going to have a little bit of a rough time reading the exposure properly. So you'll most likely have to make some exposure compensation adjustments. The TTL is going to see all that white, and it's going to tend to close the lens down a little bit more than you want it to for the best exposure on your model. Back to the setup. I've got the model standing right against the white wall, and it's important to keep her against the wall because I do want to minimize the shadows. Now let's talk about those shadows. I want to make it clear, the only people that ever ask me about the shadows are people like you. I've never had a model or a subject look at the finished picture and ask, is it okay that those shadows are there? And I've never had a subject complain about the shadows in the background. The whole idea here is to make sure that your subject looks amazing, that there is tons of personality and energy and great body language in the shot, and that nobody's going to care about those little shadows that are there. And the reason for having the light on axis, in other words, right above the lens, it's about a foot higher, and making sure that the subject is right against the wall is so that I minimize the shadows. If I bring my subject away from the wall, the shadows will start to grow. They will become more noticeable because they'll be bigger. I'm going to set the camera up on a tripod. I generally don't work on a tripod, but in this scenario, I want to make sure that all of the shots have the exact same perspective on the body. So if I'm not careful and I'm hand-holding, sometimes I shoot a little higher, sometimes I shoot a little lower, I'm going to be looking at the body from different angles, and they won't mesh together properly in a composite. So to make sure that I can't get sloppy and to make sure that everything lines up well, it's real simple. Put the camera on a tripod. That way every single shot is taken at the same altitude and it has the same body perspective. So from there, it's simply a matter of working through the 10 bikinis. For each of the bikinis, I shot probably 100 to 150 frames. The model duplicated a lot of the poses and a lot of the movements because it's not a matter of how many different things can she do. I'm looking for 5 different shots when it's over. So the real key to making the pictures work is going to be to get really good facial expressions, lots of emotion. You'll notice in the bottom of the frame, I'm using a small fan just to get a little bit of movement on her hair. This girl, as you can see, has a lot of hair, and while it's beautiful, it can get in the way. That light fan pushes the hair back off of her face, and it gives the hair a little bit more body, which makes it exciting and a little sexier. So don't be afraid to experiment with fans. Generally, the biggest mistake you'll make with a fan is turning it up too high. Now, a little tip, people with contacts will often struggle with a fan. And the reason is the fan dries out the contact lenses. Regardless of whether the person wears contact lenses or doesn't, encourage your subjects to blink normally when they're in front of the fan. Another thing that you'll notice in these shots is that I generally have the model's head essentially in a box. Very small turns, nothing big and dramatic where she's looking off. The reason for that is that these photographs are going in her modeling portfolio. So the goal here is to sell her personality and her ability to show lots of different emotions. By having her eyes closer to the camera, I'm getting more impact from them. So again, I'm not saying it's a rule that you have to have your model staring down the barrel of your lens, but hey, if they're that beautiful, why not? And in the case of these shots where I'm trying to market her, it's imperative that I don't lose the impact of those beautiful eyes. So there you have it, a simple one light direct flash glamour shot. Make sure you check out part two of this set where I'll walk you through Photoshop and how I assembled the five images to make the final composite. For now, remember, keep thinking, keep learning, and keep shooting. Adios. Thanks for watching. If you find these videos helpful, please give them a thumbs up and subscribe so that you don't miss a single episode. And if you've got a question that you would like answered, please post it in the comments section below. Your question could be my next video.